Good morning and welcome to First Christian Church. We're glad you're joining us. Would you please rise as we worship the Lord in beauty of holiness and celebrate his abundant goodness and joyfully sing of his righteousness.
Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty and so much stronger? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder and leaves us breathless in awe and wonder? The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross. You laid down your life, that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Who brings the chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King of glory. Who rules the nations with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. Yeah, this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross. Oh, you laid down your life, that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. Oh, this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross. Oh, you laid down your life, that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. All that you've done.
Hello, church. Today is Sunday, April 14th, 2024, and what an amazing grace it is to be in worship with you in the sanctuary and by church online. My name is Scott Schmidt, and I serve as one of the elders here. where we are building disciples for Jesus Christ, relationships across every generation, and compassion for all of God's children. As our acolytes bring in the light of Christ, may we dance sure with joy. May we dance sure even in the rain. And may we dance sure with the power of the Holy Spirit. Let us dare to dance again in worship together this morning. Please join our voices together to sing Happy Day. The lyrics can be found on the screens behind me.
My Savior lay, hell thought it won, cause there was hell to pay. Angels came flying, stone rolled away. Hallelujah, happy day. Whoa, Lord, sweet, sweet freedom. Whoa, sin washed away. Oh, Lord, ain't that worth dancing? Hallelujah, happy day. We gonna stomp till the earth start shaking, louder than thunder we'll sing till we came. We gonna try and outdance some angels. Hallelujah, happy day. Whoa, Lord, sweet, sweet freedom. Whoa, sin washed away. Oh, Lord, ain't that worth dancing? Hallelujah, happy day. Grave my Savior lay, hell thought it won, but hell hoped in vain. Angels came flying, stone rolled away. Hallelujah, happy day. Whoa, Lord, sweet, sweet freedom. Whoa, sin washed away. Whoa, Lord, ain't that worth dancing? Hallelujah, happy day. Whoa,
season, the season of new life and a breath of the Spirit. As we enter into this time of worship together, may we open our hearts to the renewal of our minds and our spirits. May we dare to let go again and dance with renewed vigor as we allow resurrection hope to fill our bodies and souls.
Dare to dance with dreamers, sing their song. Dare to dance their stories, sing out strong. Dare to dance with freedom your whole life long. Dare to dance again.
Sometimes we are unsure about our steps in this world. For the disciples, even while in their joy at seeing Jesus after the resurrection, they were still disbelieving and wondering. We are reminded that even though we may not know our next steps, we can be sure that they will come because we are God's beloved children. And so we have steps to follow, those of the resurrected Jesus.
Dare to dance with dreamers, sing their song. Dare to dance their stories, sing along. Dare to dance with freedom your whole life long. Dare to dance again.
Would you pray with me? Holy One, Justice Seeker, Lover of creation, you set this world in motion and gave it life. You turn to us to you when our steps are not sure. Come and dance with us. Engage with us as we seek you, so that we can be risen with Christ and in Christ. Be with us now, we pray. Amen. The peace of Christ, of the risen Lord, be with you. Now share that peace with those around you as the children come forward for children's moment.
Good morning, everybody. Now, I have a question for you. Who all has been to church camp and been around a campfire? I have. Have you told ghost stories? No, you have not. That's okay. Now, when I was your age, sometimes the ghost stories were a little scary, and I'd have to tell myself, ghosts aren't real. Do you guys have to tell yourselves that sometimes? Yeah. Well, in today's Bible story, we find ourselves asking a similar question. So, our story begins with two men, and they were on their road to a town called Emmaus. They were talking about Jesus' death and resurrection and all that had happened. As they walked, they were joined by a man. I wonder who that man was. Does anybody know? Jesus, good job. And they didn't realize it at first. After Jesus revealed himself, they went straight back to Jerusalem and told all of his disciples. As they told the disciples they had seen Jesus, he suddenly appeared among them and he said, "Peace be with you." Knowing he died, they thought he was a ghost. And the Bible says they were terrified and filled with fear. Jesus asked them, "Why are you troubled? And why do doubts arise in your hearts? Look at my hands and my feet. You can see that it's really me. Touch me and make sure that I am really here. And not a ghost, because ghosts don't have bodies, as you see that I do." The disciples still weren't sure what to think. So Jesus asked them for some food, because ghosts can't eat, can they? No. So they gave him some fish, and the disciples watched really close, and Jesus ate the fish. And they knew it was Jesus because ghosts don't need food. No, they don't need food. So the disciples realized that Jesus had come back to life, and they spent a couple months with him. After Jesus returned back to heaven, those same disciples went all over the world telling that Jesus was crucified, and his death, and his resurrection. They never stopped telling about Jesus. You and I have been called to tell others about Jesus, just like those disciples all those years ago. We must tell the world that Jesus is alive. Let us pray. Dear God, we serve a risen Savior. He is alive. Help us to be witnesses of what he has done in our lives. In Jesus' name, amen. Okay, you may go back with your grown-ups or go with Miss Jeannie for Children's Church.
My name is Colton. I have the privilege to serve as one of the pastors here. It is good to be in worship with all of you. We come to the time of our service where we get a little closer to that true community we're striving for, where we share vulnerably with each other the good parts and the hard parts of our life. Each week we have a prayer family of the week, and we have those prayer families alphabetical. And it was started by Anna Reinhart, and this week we come to the Reinhart family. And it is quite perfect that this week our prayer family is the Reinhart family. For Roger and Anna, Christian and Kennedy and Nicholas, we pray for them, and we also remember them as they grieve the loss of our beloved Dean. We remember Denise and Darren as Darren's brother died this week by homicide. And so please remember the Harris family as they grieve and mourn. Cindy Tooker is recovering and recovering well following surgery. Pat Gappa is home after a stint in the hospital. Please remember Pat in your prayers. Norma Mead asks for prayer for the Felton and Mead families. Norma's great-grandson, Creed Felton, was killed in the accident Friday evening at UConn. He was only 24 this past February. Please remember me in your prayers. I will be away this week at Bethany Fellows from Monday to Friday as a cohort of young, early-career disciples ministers. Tara and Annika are both available should you need anything emergently, in an emergency. Are there any others to share this morning? Newton. Please remember Judy Farley, who's at Mercy Hospital with pneumonia and a broken back, which is inoperable. Pete. Brooke Robertson asked that we remember Pete. Seeing no others, let us pray together. God, we come to you full of hope and doubt, wonder, even joy, and also grief. In confusion, we bring you the everyday stuff of our human lives. We know they're not foreign to you. You lived them, you experienced them, you even redeemed them. We know we are no strangers to you. You have called us children. You loved us into being. You sustain us now. But we surely need your presence and your strong arm. We need to lean together on your everlasting arms because we come in a variety of ways hurting this morning. We remember those who grieve the Reinhardt, Harris, Meade, and Felton families. We remember those who are in recovery, like Judy, Cindy, Pat. We remember Pete. We come with our joy. For spring days and plant sales. For churches with strong voices and foot stomping tunes. For the way life continues to go on. And when we have eyes to see and open hearts, we even get glory now and then. But God, we know there are some things that cannot be said aloud, but things that you hear nevertheless. And so in the silence, hear those prayers of our heart and listen well. Eternal God of resurrection, be with each of us now. May the dance of your Spirit ever call us to engage with you and the needs of the world around us. Lead us, guide us, surround us, comfort us, fill us this day. We pray this, and we pray this together, saying that prayer which Jesus taught his disciples, using whichever version or language we know best, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Teach me to dance to the beat of your heart. Teach me to move in the power of your Spirit. Teach me to move in the light of your presence. Teach me to dance to the beat of your heart.
Hear these words from the Gospel according to Luke, chapter 24, verses 36b through 48. Jesus himself stood among them and said to them, Peace be with you. They were startled and terrified and thought they were seeing a ghost. He said to them, Why are you frightened? And why do you doubt arise in your hearts? Look at my hands and my feet. See that it is I myself. Touch me and see, for a ghost does not have flesh and bones as you see that I have. And when he had said this, he showed them his hands and his feet. Yet, for all their joy, they were still disbelieving and wondering. And he said to them, Have you something to eat? They gave him a piece of broiled fish, and he took it and ate it in their presence. And he said to them, These are the words that I have spoken to you while I was still with you, that everything was written about me in the laws of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms must be fulfilled. Then he opened their minds to understand the scriptures. And he said to them, Thus it is written that the Messiah is to suffer and to rise from the dead on the third day, and that repentance and forgiveness of sins is to be proclaimed in his name to all nations, beginning from Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Thank you.
Danced in the morning when the world was begun, and I danced in the moon and the stars and the sun, and I came down from heaven and I danced on earth. At Bethlehem I had my birth. Dance then wherever you may be. I am the Lord of the dance, said he, and I'll lead you. Scribe and the Pharisee, but they would not dance and they would not follow me. I danced for the fishermen, for James and John. They came with me and the dance went on. Dance then wherever you may be. I am the Lord of the dance, said he, and I'll lead you. They whipped and they stripped and they hung me high and left me there on a cross to die. Dance then wherever you may be. I am the Lord of the dance, said he, and I'll lead you on wherever you may be, and I'll lead you all in the dance, said he.
That was pretty fun. Our second scripture today comes from 1 John chapter 3, verses 1 through 7. See what love the Father has given us, that we should be called children of God, and that is what we are. The reason the world does not know us is that it did not know Him. Beloved, we are God's children now. What we will be has not yet been revealed. What we do know is this: when He is revealed, we will be like Him, for we will see Him as He is. And all who have this hope in Him purify themselves just as He is pure. Everyone who commits sin is guilty of lawlessness. Sin is lawlessness. You know that He was revealed to take away sins. And in Him there is no sin. No one who abides in Him sins. No one who sins has either seen Him or known Him. Little children, let no one deceive you. Everyone who does what is right is righteous, just as He is righteous. May God add blessings to the readings of these words in every time and in every place. Would you pray with me? God, help us to live in this love of resurrection, of eternal childhood with You in these words that still bring new life. Speak through me, inspire me, so that we might all experience something holy, something good, and something true this day and always. Amen. So this past January, I attended Remind and Renew at Phillips Theological Seminary in Tulsa. Phillips is one of our 7 graduate theological institutions of the Christian Church Disciples of Christ. Pretty sure it's Kip Wolf's alma mater. It's the current institution where Annika studies. Remind and Renew is a more inclusive and clever name than Minister's Week, which is what almost all seminaries will host once a year, generally in the winter. And this year's theme was charting and navigating a post-2020 world. I was particularly taken by Dr. Scott Thuma's presentation. Dr. Thuma is a professor of the sociology of religion and the director for the Hartford Institute of Religious Research. Imagine having that on your business card. The Hartford Institute is one of the top institutions for religious analysis. If you've ever seen a little article that has a statistic about churches or clergy people in the United States, flip a coin. If it's heads, it was written by the Harvard Institute. Professor Thuma, or it was studied and produced, that the statistic by the Harvard Institute. Professor Thuma shared with us how the pandemic revealed what's been true for about a half century: that church attendance, dollars in the plate, the traditional way that we know the church, is not doing so well, in decline, disappearing, pick your word, cruising into 2020 before all of the events of 2020. Average worship attendance in the United States had fallen in congregations from 137 on average in the year of our Lord 2000 to 65. In 2020. Congregations like this one, First Christian in El Reno, are rare and becoming rarer. In 2023, our average worship attendance, for those who are curious, was 104. On the whole, in our history, we've had stable worship trends. These are very rare sizes and types of churches. You probably didn't know it, but nationally speaking, you're in the top 30% of church size. Professor Thuma's message was, it is well past time to change or die. It's time to be experimental, to get beyond our walls especially. The funny part is that during 2020, self-reported congregational willingness to change and innovate and be creative was an all-time high. Can't imagine why everyone was really interested in creativity. That was true for us too, of course. Anybody else remember parking lot worship? I was just saying on Sunday how wonderful that was, and Jonah said, yeah, you didn't have to cart all that stuff out there. But now, 4 years later, our need for creativity and innovation is even higher, and congregation self-reported willingness and interest in change and creativity is at a 20-year low. Tied for the all-time low, if I remember correctly. But I couldn't find my notes, so I'm having to go off memory. As it goes for the church institutional, there are a lot of reasons to be pessimistic about the outlook of our shared project in the body of Christ. And I have a lot of reasons to join Mr. Thuma in his realistic outlook for the future story of the church institutional. 6 years following my ordination, I am still the second youngest ordained clergy person in the Christian church in Oklahoma. And I'm married to the current reigning champion. And should Annika be ordained, she would be the youngest, and you would have all three here in El Reno, albeit one on a technicality. Which is great for us, but holy cow. What about the under their 115 disciples congregations? We have a real ministry pipeline problem. We do not have folks who are interested in this particular vocation. My personal graduate research was about the reality of congregational death or closure, how congregations closing represent real loss to communities, and that they have unique lessons to share throughout their whole lifespan of a congregation, but it isn't pretty when congregations are lost. Something real is lost. My home congregation, the one that nurtured me and loved me so very well, closed in the fall of 2019. Thankfully, before the pandemic would have made that choice for them, even if they hadn't been ready for it. The Disciples Camp that I attended growing up on Lake Texoma has been sold and converted into an endowment. In this congregation, our attendance was rocked in 2020 by the twin impact of a new minister and a global pandemic. And it hasn't recovered yet. And nor, adjusted for inflation especially, has our general fund giving. So these are some pretty potent signs all around. And yet what sticks with me was Professor Thuma's observation in a course statistical analysis about the mismatch between clergy perceptions and the optimism they have about their own congregation. I don't think he used the word delusional, but I certainly felt like the man of La Mancha after his presentation. Because despite it all, like most pastors, I have the greatest optimism in church. And not just Church Universal, but this one right here on the corner of Barker and London. Even on the days when working for Big C Church means that I feel like I'm working for a crusty, dusty, musty institution, I have hope. And I especially have hope in my congregation. And our scripture today is part of why I have what might be on paper unearned hope. Our selection from the Gospel of Luke begins right on the heels, as Annika helped explain to the children, of the walk to Emmaus. The walk to Emmaus is one of my favorite passages of scripture. It's almost mystical. It presents this maybe universalizing presentation of what a resurrection is and can be known to Cleopas and his companion and the breaking of the bread. The two walkers who had walked there about 7 miles from Jerusalem to Emmaus quickly retraced their steps all the way back to town, talk about a long day on the road, so that they could relay the truth that they had found to the 11 and those gathered with the 11, when suddenly Jesus zaps back in with another example of resurrection, but this one so very particular, so very specific to that man of Nazareth. And Jesus gives them two gifts. Even amidst his bad table manners, he still comes bearing gifts. First, he gives them peace. Always peace. Second, he opens their mind to the scriptures. He opens their mind to the scriptures by showing them how their story with him is part of the stories that they have read probably since they were knee-high to a grasshopper in scripture. Jesus places their shared experience within this long story of God's wide mercy, God's demand for justice, God's ceaseless love. By opening their minds, Jesus shows how even amidst what seems unimaginable, even amidst violence and death, we can still trace the movement of a benevolent God. And don't miss the ending. Jesus closes this opening of their minds with a short observation, or perhaps a renaming of this huddled community. He tells them, "You are witnesses of these things. You are witnesses of these things." In our worship series, Dare to Dance Again, we're trying to figure out how to make this commitment. This commitment to dance even after the hard times, even when life has been harsh or unfair. How do we dance boldly and joyfully, even when we've experienced pain? And I'll tell you the truth, it's been hard to figure out how to dance in these last years. And I'm sure you can count all the reasons why it would be easier to hang up your tap shoes too. But even still, I'm optimistic. I'm optimistic about the church, even 133-year-old ones, even established ones, denominational ones, because we have been witnesses of these things too. Undoubtedly, in our post-2020 context, we've been gripped, just like the disciples, by disbelief and wonder about what is happening. Not only with church, but perhaps in your pocketbook as we live through a wackadoodle economy. Not only about church, but perhaps our politics when our divisions seem to be growing wider and wider ever still. Not only about church, but our schools, as they figure out what does it mean to educate now, fill in the blank. It seems that we have lost too much. And on our worst days, we might believe that the body is broken beyond usefulness. Our body politic, the body of Christ, even our own human bodies. But just like those disciples, we still might find joy, even alongside our disbelief and our wonder. Our scripture from 1 John chapter 3 is a meditation on sin and righteousness. Helpful topics, never go out of style. But it's part of a long argument, and this long argument about how we are to live is undergirded by this particular notion that we are children of God, first, foremost, and finally. Being children of God has responsibilities toward the life we lead, avoiding sin being one of them. But it is also an unwavering affirmation that you are God's child. You are God's child. You are God's child. And you will be taken care of. So I'm one of those people who still feels optimism and joy because I've seen new life. I am a witness of these things. I'm a witness of the love that once welcomed me and holds me still. Love that I found around Logos tables, not ours, but at different churches, but also ours. At Bible studies at camp, not just this one, but one other, and also ours. And even Sunday morning worship here and beyond. That love that invited me to belong at 6 years old is still here, still working, still moving. I have joy because I think the church could be and should be, and on its best days is, the place where we look upon and we can even touch the wounds in the body of Christ, inspect them, take hold of them, experience the woundedness that comes from our violence or our racism, or our exclusion, or simply our apathy, and see the ways in which it hurts the body, and promise to one another, no more, no more sin. I have joy because I think that the church could be and should be, and on its best days, is still the place where if a hungry body shows up and says, do you have anything to eat? They're still given a meal, a simple meal of broiled fish, or as often happens around here, chicken nuggets, or breakfast for dinner. In a slow week, 200 people eat out of our kitchen, and over 100 high schoolers take snack packs to go with them to make it through the weekend. I still think that the body of Christ could be and should be, and on its best days, is a place where people gather semi-regularly, perhaps once a week, maybe even on a Sunday, sheltered by walls and sometimes closed doors, and still find joy when Jesus shows up in the middle of it all, even in the middle of pain and grief and doubt. Joy, because it could be and should be, and on our best days it is the case, that our minds are open to seeing God's long story and realize that we are part of that story. And that story includes all of us, even the evil that we've experienced, even the sin that we have enacted or anticipated or condoned, and yet ends with resurrection. We are witnesses too. And because we have experienced this great love, because we have participated in it, because our minds have been opened to seeing our story as part of God's story, we can dance. We can dance sure and steady. We can dance with joy even on the days when we are met with disbelief and wonder. It won't always be good. It hasn't always been good. But we have seen more than the bad stuff. We are also witnesses of new life. We are also witnesses of missions of mercy and justice. We are witnesses of children and youth coming into their own. We are witnesses of adults finding actual friends, which is a minor miracle. We are witnesses of the love of Jesus being shared. We are also witnesses of these things. So if we open our minds, if we dare to dance again, and we just might witness resurrection too. Amen.
If you would please join me in our communion hymn this morning, we're going to be singing Come Celebrate Jesus.
Helps you even today realize that there is more than to the life than the tough time that you're going to through right now. Maybe it helps you define yourself. Often when we're confused, upset, or grieving, we turn to comfort food to help us get through difficult days and nights. And we're not alone in this. When the resurrected Jesus appeared to his disciples that Sunday evening, throwing them into utter confusion, he asked for something to eat, and they gave him fish. When we gather for worship, there may be times when we're confused, dismayed, or disappointed. Perhaps we are yearning for comfort food, and we find that comfort in small pieces of bread and simple sips of juice. Not surprising, we also are empowered and equipped to dance sure because of that meal. We gather around Christ's table that has no need of supersizing. We know just a taste of bread and a simple sip of juice shared in community are the core ingredients of a diet that helps us to dance together in faith. So we remember Jesus in that upper room with his disciples when he took the loaf of bread and after blessing it, he broke it and said, "Take and eat, this is my body given for you." Then in the same manner, he took the cup and after giving thanks, he said, "Drink from it, all of you, for this is the body of Christ poured out to you for many. I will not drink of this cup or eat of this bread till I drink it new with you in my Father's house." Let us pray.
Dear God, you have given us life. We praise you for bringing us into a new community of love through Jesus Christ, who asks that we remember him with this loaf and cup. By your word and Holy Spirit, bless these elements in this congregation that we may receive Christ, our own life given for us. Forgive us and strengthen us in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Soon trays will come your way, and we invite you to taste, eat, and see that indeed God is good, and then to serve your neighbors as yourself. We are disciples of Christ, a movement for wholeness in a fragmented world. All are welcome to the table as God has welcomed us. If you are worshiping with us online, we invite you to take whatever you may have. It becomes holy because God is there with you. Let us partake.
Thank you. your bulletin, you'll find a communication card with a perforated edge. Let's rip that in 3, 2, 1. Please fill that out and make sure that we have your best information. In addition to our regular offering, this April, we have a special giving in phrase for our service, learning, and mission, or SLAM Fund. Our SLAM Fund makes a big impact for Jesus. When children, youth, or adults are sent from the corner of Barker and London to the ends of the earth to learn, serve, or participate in Holy Mission, it is the SLAM Fund that sends them. The SLAM Fund makes an impact when we send youth on their introductory trip to Eureka Springs to hear more about the impact the Eureka Springs youth has had. Please turn your attention to the screens behind me.
My name is Derek Harris. Got to go to Eureka Springs.
Sienna Meadens. Last year I went to Eureka Springs, Arkansas. We went to the Great Posh Hut. We walked around town. Had a lot of fun.
My favorite part of the trip was the Esther play. It felt very much real to me. It felt like the play came to life.
The most fun thing I got to do was the first play we went to. The play was about Esther. Helped a lot of the other people in her community.
Like, it felt worth it to me. It felt like I was included. It felt very cool. I learned new things while there.
It's a great point on the Eureka Springs trip. I actually went back for my birthday.
Thank you for having an impact in my life.
Thank you for helping me and my friends go to Eureka Springs, and thank you for helping other people get to go.
The ministries that the SLAM Fund provides will have an impact on me as well. I will be eligible to go on the next Eureka Springs trip currently scheduled for summer 2025. Our ambitious goal of 20,000 will provide for our project needs in 2024 and 2025. Never doubt your SLAM Fund giving makes an impact for Jesus and for those who follow him. If you are able, please make an over and above gift for the service, learning, and mission fund. The morning's offering of our SLAM Fund special offering and our communication cards will now be received.
Please rise. Praise him above ye heavenly host.
receive these gifts, loving God, as signs and symbols of our love for you and for the beloved children you have created. Thank you for all you have freely offered these gifts. Help us use each contribution to make an impact. Allow us to serve, learn, and participate in holy missions from our doorsteps to the end of the earth. Amen.
My friends, perhaps it is the case that you have witnessed resurrection and you too want to dance along with that man from Nazareth. In this church, we confess that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God, and together we proclaim him Lord and Savior of our lives and of the world. If you would like to join the body of Christ, we welcome you and we will make arrangements for your baptism. If you are a baptized member of the body of Christ, you're welcome to come forward as we stand and sing, Joyful, Joyful, We Adore Thee, number one.
Joyful, joyful.
Be seated. You all stay. You're good. You're good. What a wonderful day. Questa Carter has come to transfer her membership from Friendship Baptist Church in California, and Destiny, Jasmine, and Leah have come to make their confession of faith. And so I ask all of you, what has been asked of me, do you confess that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God, and you proclaim him Lord and Savior of your life? If so, say, I do. And congregation, do you reaffirm this same faith? Do you confess that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God, and do you proclaim him Lord and Savior of your lives and of the world? If so, say, we do. If you will take out your trusty blue chalice hymnal and turn to 341 so that we might pray together for these four, for Destiny and Jasmine, Leah and Questa. Reaffirming our own faith in Jesus the Christ, we gladly welcome you into this community of faith, enfolding you with our love and committing ourselves to your care. In the power of God's Spirit, let us mutually encourage each other to trust God and strengthen one another to serve others, that Christ's church may, in all things, stand faithful. Welcome. As you leave today, they'll be under the stained glass window. Please welcome them with Christian love and let them know how glad we are that they are part, have been for a long time, and continue to be part of our community. As you leave worship today, I have three quick things for you to note. First is that next week is we have a very special guest. The Reverend Chris Dorsey will be in. Chris is the president of Disciples Home Missions. It's one of the big two arms of the mission of our general church. He is here as a we are the sample of Oklahoma disciples as he goes to all of the regions of the Christian church. To help entice you, in case denominational bigwigs aren't enough, we have a potluck after worship. So if he doesn't bring you, the potluck had better. Which, also bring a dish to share. Two, Logos Celebration, the last Logos of the school year, is a celebration. Woo! And it is Wednesday, April the 24th. 6 p.m. is the program and promotion, and then 6:30 is a picnic. And then number three, we are sending out college care packages this month. Please bring gift cards, approximately like $10 gift cards. Bring them to share. We need them by the 21st, so next Sunday if you can. That is a wonderful way we're able to show our college students a little bit of love and a little bit of care as they go through finals. Now, would you please rise to receive these words of blessing? As the song recorded by Leanne Womack goes, I hope you never lose your sense of wonder. You get your fill to eat, but always keep that hunger. May you never take one single breath for granted. God forbid love ever leave you empty-handed. I hope you still feel small when you stand beside the ocean. Whenever one door closes, I hope one more opens. Promise me that you'll give faith a fighting chance. And when you get the choice to sit it out or dance, I hope you dance. And so may the loving God, the risen Christ, and the dancing Spirit fill you with all that you need for the days ahead. And may all of God's people say, amen. Please join your hands and hearts for our final blessing. I hope you dance.
Whenever one door closes, I hope one more opens. Promise me that you'll give faith a fighting chance. And when you get the choice to sit it out,